Hello and a warm welcome to the CNBC Africa special in partnership with the KwaZulu-Natal Economic Council, coming to you from the city of Durban. I'm Gugulethu Cele. Now, South Africa is well documented as one of the most unequal societies in the world, with a Gini coefficient of 0.4%, ranging to 0.66%. It does seem as though we are leaning towards the wrong end of that particular scale, very close to representing one of the most unequal societies in the globe. But we all know that inequality has its roots deeply set in the days of colonialism and the deliberate exclusion of independent individuals as economic participants and wealth creators. But 21 years on into democracy, how far has the country, and more importantly, the province of KZN, come in managing to alleviate the issues regarding inequality in the province? Well, we will debate this with a esteemed level of panelists joining us today regarding the KZN province, a province which is the second most significant contributor to South Africa's GDP, boasts a population of well over 10 million individuals, and has several industries and sectors well-positioned and poised for sustainable economic growth as well as contribution and development to the South African GDP. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome on stage my esteemed panelists. We'll start off with the convener of government, Mr. Michael Mabuyakhulu, who's the MEC for Economic Development, Tourism and Environmental Affairs in the province of KwaZulu-Natal. The convener for the organized business, Mr. Akash, who is the chairman of the KZN Business Chambers Council. We thereafter are followed by the convener of civil society and a member of the South African National Civic Organization in KZN is Mr. Sthembiso Madlala. We are also followed by the convener of labor, Mr. Edward Mkhize, who is the provincial secretary of Cosatu, and our thought leader on today's panel discussion, Mr. Zakhele, who is a political analyst as well as a lecturer on international relations and international political economy at the University of KwaZulu-Natal. Now, we're not alone. We also have a wonderful group of audience members, many of whom representing different sectors of society and stakeholders within the economic landscape of KZN, who will be participating in the panel discussion throughout today. You too can also join the conversation at home and share your feedback and thoughts with us on the outcomes of this particular discussion using the hashtag KZNRoundtable410. Without wasting any more time, ladies and gentlemen, if we look at the topic regarding inequality, and I'd like to start off with my panel here by getting the opening remarks from each of you. It seems as though it is a topic which is quite front and center, not only in the local landscape, but also from a global proposition. Just recently at the Nelson Mandela lecture, we had world-renowned French economist Thomas Piketty coming forward telling South Africans that tax on the wealthy is what will help bolster economic growth in South Africa, as well as eradicate the levels of inequality. Now, many people have had mixed views when it comes to this particular argument, given the fact that the top 10% of the richest individuals in South Africa actually account and hold close to 60 to 65% of the overall wealth in the country. MEC, tax on the wealthy, is this a proposed measure that we need to employ by the economist Piketty?
Well, first and foremost, I believe that you cannot have a silver bullet solution in solving the problem of poverty inequality. However, you need an array of interventions. One such intervention, amongst many, might be the issue of the tax on the wealthy. However, when we introduce that tax, it must be a tax that we are well guarded as a nation, that we deploy those resources in an appropriate manner, as we do, because if you look at our budget, almost close to about 7 to 8% goes towards the interventions that are seeking to redress the immediate situation of those who find themselves in the doldrums. So I think the principle of a tax on the wealthy as one of many interventions might therefore be considered a good proposition.
One of the many interventions, as you say, MEC. Akash, I'd like to get your view on this. Naturally, you represent business leaders, thought leaders, capitalists, who are also made up of some of those wealthy. Your thoughts on how they might respond to this?
I think Thomas Piketty's timing was just appropriate for this discussion. I think, Thomas, it's easy to comment from the side. As the MEC says, I think as business, you can't paint everything with one brush, so you can't just have a straight wealth tax on everyone. we think that's going to kill the goose that's going to lay the golden egg that's going to help this economy drive out inequality. But I think you mentioned earlier, you know, inequality is deep-rooted in colonization. So it's easy for Thomas to suggest a wealth tax. Is he willing himself to contribute part back to this inequality of being from one of those nations that colonized Africa? And I think it's at that level we must start this debate and have this theoretical argument. And business is ready to engage in that form.
Mm-hmm. Let's get the voice from civil society. Sthembiso?
Yeah, I think it's long overdue. Actually, it's not just being introduced now. During the transition and the transformation period towards 1994 and further on, this issue was discussed quite strongly. There were discussion papers that were presented on the taxation of the wealthy, but it was shelved somehow for the benefit of those who are still benefiting right now. So it's not just a new phenomenon, but as I'll agree with the MEC that it's a multifaceted kind of a phenomenon that need to be addressed using different methods. But this thing is long overdue because the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. Then we always repeat this rhetoric of being an unequal society. So it doesn't make sense.
Edward, you represent Labour. Perhaps the individuals who fall into that bracket that Sthembiso mentioned, poor getting poorer. Does this stem true?
Thanks, Coco. Let me greet you and greet all the panelists and the plenary. I think, as we have indicated, that's what we also highlighted in our engagement, that the inequality that we are talking about, it's a centuries issue. It's an issue that is deep in our colonial economy. And we think there are a number of interventions that have been done, but sometimes we need just to take a step back and go back to the drawing board and check if those interventions are really working for us. So you are raising this matter. Fortunately, tomorrow, as we are sitting here, as Cosatu will be on strike, we will be on stairway tomorrow as Cosatu. And this is one of the issues that we have picked up, because you know there is this proposal on the VAT increase. And as Cosatu, we are saying that you can increase VAT across the board. You must understand this level of inequality, because you cannot have a situation where you find that someone who's not working, the poor of the poorest, if there is something like that, we go to the shop, you buy bread with a business millionaire using the same price of the bread. If the bread is 10 rand, it's 10 rand for the millionaire, it's 10 rand for the poor. Mm. And we are saying that if, as long as the distribution of our economy is unequal, we can then expect that we also contribute equally. And we think it's that notion, it's something that really have to be engaged, it's something that have to be discussed, and it's in line with what we are exactly emphasizing as Cosatu. Mm.
I want us to, before we get your opening points, Zakhele, I want us to actually emphasize on the point that you mentioned. Cosatu will be going on a stay away tomorrow. Mm. We know that there also is labor unrest when it comes to the gold sector, the coal mining sector in South Africa overall. And many of the times when we read about these headlines, we read it with squirmishness and nervousness with regard to the impact that that will have on the South African economic landscape overall. When it comes to KZN as a province, these stayaways, how do we alert labor to the impact that it has on an economic landscape, but also having them understand that productivity might also equal into increased equality should they have a responsible approach to it?
We understand what you are raising. We understand the role of labor in the economy. But, Gogo, if truth be told, because you don't have to be a rocket scientist in order to see that there is an inequality. If truth be told, you yourself, you are a witness that there are a number of issues that we have raised as Labour, where we have emphasized that some interventions have to be done in order to address this inequality. And our economy has been very stubborn. So you know that the only tool that we have as Labour to make our voice felt is to embark in some of the activities. And this is one of the activities of which we think that as much as there will be that impact on productivity, but if our voice is heard and we are able to address those concerns, it's going to be a long-lasting solution for our country.
Mm-hmm. Zakhele, I'd like to come to you just to get your opening views with regard to the tax on the wealthy as well as the implications as we see having an impact on labour using their voice, very loud and very vocal, and physical halting of productivity onto the economic landscape of the province.
Yes, thank you very much. Let me just begin by saying that I think what we have seen in the past is that when it comes to this kind of debates, people tend to be very ideological, and I think we need to be very careful about clinging to ideology. I think that it's important that we try and find workable solutions to solving the problems that we face. I mean, if you go to the United States, for example, there's always the debate between Republicans and Democrats around the issue of tax. The Republicans tend to favor low taxes, and the Democrats tend to favor higher taxes. And at the end of the day, I say it's not just about high taxes or low taxes, but I think it's about trying to find some sort of middle ground and avoid extremes. So the issue of tax for me, I think it could work in some situations, but I think we shouldn't get ourselves caught up in ideological debates, even though ideology is, as a political scientist, you know, we always talk about ideology, but I tend to refrain from being too ideological when it comes to seeking solutions to problems.
Mm. Well, we just had an opening briefing held by the HOD of the Economic Department and Development here in the province of KZN, and he alluded to the question, how do you define inequality? You've alluded to that, as well as the spending power of individuals, especially those representing the labour society. That definition, how do we define it, given the fact that should there be a redistribution of wealth, a recent calculation by some of our peers in the industry alluded to Johan Rupert, one of the richest men in South Africa. He's $6.4 billion worth of income. If you split that by well over 50% of the individuals who are living below the poverty line in South Africa, they'd only get about 5,000 rand each, which would hardly make much of a difference to their income. So this inequality, how do we describe it from a definition point of view? And are we all on the same page as members of different sectors and organizations when it comes to defining it? Sthembiso, I'd like to start with you and coming to the MEC.
Yeah, it's mostly about the per capita income, which we think can be able to decrease the gap between the rich and the poor. So inequality also, as I've mentioned, that it is multifaceted. So it also entails that those who are rich should contribute towards supporting the small businesses and the cooperatives. Right now, we see that it's only the government initiatives that are supporting the small and emerging businesses and the cooperatives. And the private sector is just distancing itself from supporting the emerging, especially the black businesses, the ones that are most of the time marginalized. So it's their commitment to say that we are contributing, because all these legislations and policies, the BEE, it hasn't worked very well, because there is no willpower on the part of the business to transform, whereas the government has created a very conducive legislative framework for transformation economy, of the economy. But those who still hold the economic power are very much not willing to transform.
Akash, we'll come back to you in a moment to get your view from the business sector. But MEC, coming back to that particular definition of inequality, are there similarities that can be drawn given what Sthembiso has shared?
Well, let me start from what people would say in the law of dialectics, the law of unity and conflict of the opposites. If there is one debate which articulates that everything flows, everything changes, that there's absolutely nothing that is stagnant, the point of departure in this argument, in this debate that we're having, for me, our starting point is understanding the nexus between poverty, unemployment, and inequality. And I'm saying, therefore, that any artificial distinction that tend to take inequality and put it there, because inequality results out of people who are poor, who are afflicted by poverty, people who are unemployed. If you are able to deal with this, you then have a greater chance of reducing inequality. And I'm not saying that by extension, you should not deal with the gap between the rich and the poor and be able, therefore, to have very well-calculated interventions that begins to bridge the gap between the well-off, where the wealthy and the poor. However, our own debate is the fact that we should be talking about the fact that on the ground, because the debate is not must be about defining inequality. The debate must be about we do have people who are poor. So therefore, they have got an unequal society as we speak. Mm-hmm. It's the truth. So I think what is important for us is to talk about the interventions. However, it is important for me to also deal with the issue that I thought Mr. Mkhize did deal with it. The question of VAT and how the state deals with this. As government, we do agree and accept that you do need to be able to be very considerate to actually to develop and come up with measures that are able to ameliorate the plight of those who are poor. But how do you do that? You zero rate certain basic stuff. And it's exactly what we have done so that we can give a relief to the poor. But there is a limit in which you can do that. So not only are we dealing with that from that issue, but also dealing with it around the question of tax, in terms of income tax. You are able, therefore, to provide greater relief, because that relief directly goes to the individuals, as opposed zero rating basic stuff and increasing that pool, because if you increase that pool, it will benefit the rich equally, and therefore deprive those who want. So you will not be able to have the net gains in the collection systems. So we think we are therefore creating better measures by using the income tax as a base from which you are able to provide the relief to those who actually deserving the most.
So government managing to provide relief, but Sthembiso alluded to business also playing a hand here. And we hear about the policies that have been implemented by the state with regard to BEE as well as aiding transformation. But I'm hoping that Akash, together with Edward, we can get your views on what business is doing beyond corporate social responsibility spend. Are we finding tangible examples where previously disadvantaged individuals own more than just equity, but are now able to become decision makers to sit at the table? We also recently had the procurement summit taking place here in the province of KZN, where again it was discussed how to handle that and manage it efficiently, where chambers, many of which you represent within the KZN context, provide that facilitation between big business and small business and hopefully reach the bottom line when it comes to labor. Akash, your views?
I think just going back, Google, to what you're saying is how do we define inequality? There's a vast array. You know, if you look at the Gini coefficient, do you look at it before transfers, after transfers, the ones that you quoted, 0.6, 0.3 or 0.64, is preferably before transfers. Before government investment 150 billion rand every year into to 16 million people to provide basic social support. And that 150 billion rand comes from somewhere. It comes largely from working class people. It comes from businesses that create. So business is working hard to create part of that pool that is going to be redistributed. But I don't think it's business must absolve itself. I think you mentioned Thomas Piketty. He'll tell you theoretically there's only two things that could reduce this inequality. One is a focus on political reform and influence and to drive the initiative, which MEC has mentioned some of the initiatives. The other one is economic reform. We have this outburst of growth that's going to fix this particular problem at the grassroots level. So business, in its commitment, is working hard to keep those coffers up, keeping it topped up. But I think what business wants to do now is to look at new economies. Look at, you know, as our president looked at the sea economy, the blue economy, looking at driving not the same old industries, looking at future industries to create that economic growth, because that's where business can influence the greatest. We can lobby against political reform and make sure it's an engaging environment for business, but we must do what we're good at, is to grow the economic base. And no one's better to do it than business.
How do you do it in a matter that will appease members of Cosatu and other affiliates and labor overall, so that when they feel as though they're not receiving efficient reward, that they don't halt production?
You see, business doesn't operate in a vacuum. Business operates in an ecosystem. And key to an equal ecosystem is education, is having labor reform that is engaging. We have possibly the strongest form of labor reform or legislation in the world, one of the newest forms of legislation. Sometimes some business, not all the businesses, thinks it's too difficult to trade in. But I think we've got the key ingredients. And I think what's important is this economic council is a start in this province, is where business is committed to labor and civil society. And we're saying we want to have that conversation, but we want to have plans behind this conversation. And more importantly, we want to start implementing. And we've started to do this over the last 3 years under the leadership of the MEC, is to say, let's have the conversation. We won't have all the answers immediately, but we can start working together. We've got the ingredients. We have the labor reform that talks to a new world, a new kind of economy.
Hmm. Edward, I want to get your response. If you feel that business is committed and making sustainable ground when it comes to alleviating the inequality problems that you face with some of your unions. Zakhele, then I want to come to you on getting the issue of education, which Akash alluded to. How do we use that as a facilitator as well, an enabler when it comes to addressing the issues of inequality? Edward?
Yeah. Firstly, I must indicate, Kuku, that inequality manifests itself in a number of ways. You would observe, you'll see that there is what you call poverty inequality. There is income inequality. Inequality also manifests itself in terms of education and skills in a number of ways, and even in terms of service delivery, where you'll talk of the special service delivery. Where you find that in the African townships, KZN is one of the province that is hugely rural. You find that the e-service delivery in those townships, they're substandard as compared to the service delivery in the suburb where wealthy people live. So it manifests itself in a number of ways, and it should be, even in our approach, we should be holistic. But coming to the issue of business, Akash, you see, I'm not talking like that because I'm from labor. But we think that business could be doing more than what is doing currently.
What would you like to see them do?
You see, first, let's start here. Yeah, Google. When we were debating the national minimum wage, we've conducted a study. That study has shown that 50% of South Africans were living below the income minimum living level, of which, if you check, there was a Sunday Times at some time that has showed the list of the 10 wealth people in the country, whom we're told that in share, those 10 wealth people worth about 205 billion. And if you check Google, among that 10, most of those people are the CEOs of companies. And I can go through to say which companies are those. And if you also check, you'll find that those companies that you are talking about are the companies mostly that do not actually observe labor rights. you find that it's companies that employ workers as casuals, it's companies that employ workers through labor brokers, it's companies where you find that the conditions of workers are highly poor. And we think that in terms of share, we cannot say at this stage when you talk about share that we expect that at least, but we need to be reasonable. We need to be reasonable and observe some labor rights. The majority of the companies, if you go there, mm-hmm. you'll find that most of the of the workers in those companies do not have benefits. Do not have benefits. If you are looking for stats, Google, I'm sure you'll see for yourself. You'll have to work for the whole year in order to get those stats, because we always meet those workers. They don't have something like pension. They don't have something like medical aid. They don't have all those things. And you find that the government will find itself being responsible for building houses for people sometimes who work for those private companies, but who cannot afford houses. You find that people who work for those companies, they are the ones that are flooding hospitals because they don't have medical aid. And you are saying that we think that in terms of share, business can add value to its employees or to its workers in order to uplift at least the sustainable livelihood of many other South Africans and contribute in the social responsibility of our society.
I agree with you, and I think maybe perhaps one of the solutions that we're hoping to identify there is the spirit with which business actually decides to explore or implore rather its BEE policies as well as investment in individuals. Akash, before we get there, I want us to talk about investment in individuals. In 2012, there was a report that identified that an individual who has 14 years of schooling, in other words, completes their primary as well as higher education, but also gets tertiary education, even if it is at the most minimalistic level, will actually be able to double their income for the rest of their lives versus an individual who only has 12 years of schooling, being primary and higher high school education. It almost seems to me as though, Zakhele, to come to you and get your views on education, that business needs to be doing more than perhaps just increasing salaries, and labor also needs to be committed to also upskilling themselves, because clearly, through upskilling in individuals, investment in human capital development, and the human development index, as we see in the province of KZN, which is also increasing through some measures and policies that have been put in place by government, that this is perhaps yet another element that can be explored to bridge that inequality gap. Are we doing enough in that regard?
Okay, let me begin by just talking briefly about inequality. Akash mentioned the Gini coefficient, which measures the distribution of income. It doesn't really measure the distribution of wealth. And I think that's where we have to be very careful, because I think our focus today seems to be on incomes, but we are not really focusing on distribution of wealth. And the reason why it's difficult to talk about the distribution of wealth is that sometimes it becomes very difficult to measure things such as property, paintings, jewelry, which are the assets that the wealthy hold. So, but, you know, just I thought I should just mention that, because when we talk about inequality generally, we are focusing on distribution of incomes. But coming back to education, it's something that I'm very passionate about. I think that education can play a very important role in addressing the issue of inequality. I think one of the biggest challenges we face today in South Africa is that we are producing a lot of graduates. Mm. But I think the question I'm going to ask is, are we producing quality graduates? And I think that is the biggest challenge for us right now. Because someone was talking about unemployed graduates. It's a big challenge, but also are some of these graduates employable? That is another question. So I think we need to take those things into account.
Just if I may interject there, then whose responsibility is it to ensure that these graduates are receiving, number one, quality education and are employable? Does it mean that we need perhaps a more united voice from government and business where the policies employed and the deliverables and expectations on businesses' side are met?
No, definitely. We need the intervention of business, of government, definitely. I think it would help if we could see, especially business, coming in and working with universities to make sure that universities produce graduates that can come into the labor market and add value, and also produce entrepreneurs, because I think that's another area that we are not focusing on. We need to make sure that we produce people who can be creative enough to start their own businesses and not just complete their studies just to go and look for work, but also to become more innovative and start their own businesses. You know, I look at someone like Zuckerberg. We could produce a Zuckerberg from Umlaz, from Guamashu. You know, if our education system was good, and I think we could do that.
Indeed. Well, we're going to take a short ad break. We will continue with this round table, taking a look at inequality. We'll be back right after this. Hello and a warm welcome back to this KZN Economic Council roundtable, where the conversation in focus today revolves around inequality. Just before the ad break, Zakhele was giving us his views on the approach that we need to explore with regard to education and ensuring that that is used as an element. We've touched on tax. But Sthembi, so to come to you, are we losing the plot somewhere when it comes to understanding the relationship, especially from a labor point of view? And I'll get you an opportunity to respond as a member of civil society with regard to productivity. In the last conversation with the KZN Economic Council, Stephen Friedland said productivity is a measure on management, never mind the bottom worker. So how do we address that, especially in the context of the overall environment that we operate in?
Yeah, it's difficult to address the issue of productivity without addressing the issue of who owns the wealth itself. You see, so you'll find that the labor, the workers are selling their labor to the market. But the reality of the matter is that they're not receiving or benefiting what they're supposed to be benefiting. So the fact of the matter is that talking about the economy and also the distribution of wealth cannot be addressed also without addressing the race issue, which is still a national question, which has been become a taboo in South Africa. Just recently, if you look at the news these days, there's been a drop in the number of CEOs to 10% in South Africa. So the transformation of the economy cannot be dismissed from the transformation of the race question in South Africa. So those things, as we were saying, that it's a multifaceted and a complex issue, the issue of wealth. So addressing it, it should be addressed in a rounded manner, in a manner that this platform, like the Economic Council, KZN Economic Council, is saying. Just if you look at the mission of the KZN Economic Council, where it says to achieve a transformed, vibrant, and inclusive economy through strategic partnership, investment, and so on. So that's what we require. That's why we are here together. But the reality of the matter, I would not like to persecute Akash, because he's really representing just a tiny sector of the bigger multinational companies. So the reality of the matter is that they are not a homogeneous sector. So we've got these multinational companies that we are unable to control and regulate. So once we reach that stage to say they must play according to the South African rules, and then we'll, 20 years down the line, we'll still be talking about inequality.
Mm. How do we ensure MEC that the appropriate policies and measures that have been put in place are actually working? Are we managing to evaluate the progress that we're making and having that discussion together with business, labor, and other stakeholders in the society?
Gugu, let me start by saying there are things that as a society and as social partners, we must emphasize upon. The first of those is the question of collective ownership of the challenges and of solutions. If I were to go back and just touch on the issue of productivity must become a core shared. It must be co-owned, because unless, of course, we are able to become highly productive as a nation and we increase our productivity, we will lag behind other nations, and therefore we will be less competitive with those nations and will trade less with those nations, and it would be cost efficient for anyone, it would be highly costly for anyone to invest in our economy and will be shunned by the investment market. Mm. Of course, it is therefore important. So both management as well as workers, all of us therefore, must have a sense of co-ownership of some of these processes. Of course, accepting that there is a difference between the question of those who own the means of production and those who are selling their labor. But within that, there's a responsibility which must be shared and co-owned. Coming back to the interventions, I think it is important, and I want to mention about four things around that. The first thing in our view is that as a province, we have put together and put forward what we term the KZN Provincial Alleviation Strategy. And that strategy is hallmarks, is about three things in the main. The first is to recognize people who are currently in a crisis. And therefore saying those who go to bed without eating anything. Therefore the state, together with all social partners, must intervene for someone who needs to be able to put bread on the table. And therefore we've come up with an approach that profiles those families. We have established war rooms through all the Sugumasake program. The state, therefore, as Akash has mentioned, is able then, through social grants and other transfers, able then to alleviate those people from falling into the cracks. But it is a short measure so that we are able to get people out of those doldrums. But we must actually have a stepwise approach. When we move them, we must move them to the second level, which we call it the level of stabilizing them, and the safe mode. In the safe mode, we must then be talking about those people beginning to actually contribute to become independent, but starting the processes, whether in agriculture, whether it's enterprise development, which is skills development. So having an array of interventions that begins to be interlinked from a crisis mode, you move up the ladder to the safe mode, in other words, but from the safe mode, you move to the third ladder, which is thriving, where you become competitive, because each and every citizen, each and every individual will derive maximum satisfaction by being independent, by actually thriving like all others. So that is the first thing. So our strategy of alleviation, of eradicating poverty in the province, begins to realize that there has therefore to be direct intervention. But that can't be done on its own. Mm. The second level, therefore, becomes the issue of social partners agreeing on a trajectory for development and growth. Unless we are growing this economy in a manner, for instance, that the historically disadvantaged are able to own enterprises, to own means of production, you shall forever have a perennial problem. Mm. And therefore, we are very clear as government, we are very clear as society, that we need then to change the status quo, and we change the status quo by opening up opportunities for people to be empowered. That is why, therefore, that the state, through state procurement, is able then to begin to look at how do we begin to develop enterprise, because it must become enterprise development to ensure that you give people an opportunity. But we don't want people to be entirely dependent on the state. We want people to be able to do business with the economy as a whole, because the state only can contribute about 30%. 70% of the total GDP output is in the private hand. And as government, we realize that. So it's important that all of us work on that. That's why, if you look at chapter one of our social accord, it emphasizes these issues. Chapter two of the social accord also emphasizes these issues. But included in chapter two is an issue of focusing on women and women's Development Economic Empowerment Strategy, because women constitute a core of those who are afflicted by poverty, who are indeed, they have got the lowest of income. And we must therefore focus and elevate those people and be able to give them skills, but also give them opportunities. The third area is around what I would term the question of immediate interventions that now begin to look at the economy as a whole. We are actually saying in this country, we must look at the sectors for growth. And we have said as a province of KwaZulu-Natal, if we were to identify our key, five key critical sectors for growth, we have identified manufacturing, and therefore we have come up with what is called the industrial economy caps of the province, over and above the special economic zones. And it is important that the economy must be thriving, and therefore we must look at the issues of what people do and ensure that South Africa becomes competitive. The second of the sectors is in the area of the tourism. So we're looking at opportunities for people in the tourism sector. The third one is agriculture and agricultural massification. Agriculture in KwaZulu-Natal has got a huge, huge propensity. Mm. The fourth one, of course, is to look at issue of infrastructure. And for us, infrastructure development becomes quite crucial for the province of KwaZulu-Natal. Because if you look at our ports, if you look at our road, all of these issues are crucial. Of course, the last issue is the oceans economy. And we are therefore beginning to say, if I were to take the key five ones and say, that is where in the main, as we are driving the interventions around the question of inequality or poverty, that we take people out, we are not taking our eyes out of the bigger picture, that is to develop an economy that creates opportunities for us all. Mm. And therefore, that is where this council and its main thrust overall, that you can only be able to have a hope of sustainable growth only and only if we are applying this multifaceted approach to us dealing with this problem.
A multifaceted approach which needs ongoing evaluation as you
Absolutely.
Go to MEC. Well, we'll open up the floor now to the audience to pose their questions and opinions to the panel. We've got a question from the MEC of Finance in KZN right up front here. We've got an opinion and a question. We'll take two questions at a time, pose them to the panel, and then come back to the audience. MEC?
Thank you. Mine is more of a comment. Just to say, I've been listening to the panel, but wealth tax is not a new concept in South Africa. We've already introduced the Katz and the Davis Commission, and there is an element of wealth tax already in existence through capital gains tax, estate duty, and donations tax. And what Professor Thomas Piketty is proposing is a progressive annual tax on net individual wealth. And we, even if it starts at a very low base. And I think it's very important for government to explore the merits of this proposal. But this must be done with due cognizance to South Africa's revised down economic growth forecast, which has just been done by the World Bank, down to 1.7% in 2016. And that obviously is largely due to our low commodity prices and the slowdown in China. So whatever tax reforms government does introduce needs to be careful that it does not become a disincentive to investment, because the state of our economy has a direct impact on the state fiscus. I also just wanted to make a comment on what Sthembiso said from civil society, and I agree with him, that at the moment, government is the only sector that seems to be supporting small and micro business. And we need to refocus our efforts on alternative job creation mechanisms for the poor. One of the issues that were raised as well was social grants, and these are going to stay on the table until the issue of unemployment is being addressed. And it is very much part of the poverty alleviation program of the provincial government. But business needs to partner with government in this regard, because government is not an employment agency. What I'm essentially doing is asking business to come to the fore, even if it increases their risk in the short term, to assist government in this regard.
MEC, thank you so much for your comment. We'll get another question from the gentleman behind you. You had your hand up, sir, and then Akash will come to you for your response.
Thank you very much. My name is Thembiso. I'm actually from Cosatu. I'm not sure whether I will be missing the point, but I just want to direct the question in terms of what impact does corruption plays in terms of inequality? Because there are monies that are supposed to help the poor but doesn't reach the poor. So that is my only question that I have. Okay, the second one is in terms of the contribution by business. We understand that business, in terms of skills, they will train ordinary workers in terms of how to operate their business. But you'll find that when, you know, with the large scale of retrenchments and company closures, those people cannot survive with the skills they obtained from the relevant companies when they are outside. When in fact the contribution should be saying, how do we build a society that will be able to sustain themselves even beyond them leaving their employment places? Those are my two questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your question. Akash, maybe it's fair that we start off with you, getting your responses to both the MEC's question and that of Themba, representing Cosatu, with regard to support that the private sector is offering when it comes to building up small and medium enterprises, together with his question regarding skills development.
Okay, I think let's just start firstly with the MEC's suggestion that, yep, we have to look at a wealth tax, but we'll need to look at it in the broader context. And you're right, MEC, there are many taxes that are already on wealth that are indirect taxes that not only tax you while you're living, when you're dead as well. To look at taking part of your particular estate and contributing it to the fiscus. But I think business would encourage that a review of these taxes, but to look at it in the context of the impact that it's going to have to capital in this economy. Not only capital from abroad, because that's the easiest form of capital to leave, but more important to capital that's already in the existing economy, to say, do they have the confidence to take out that cash and invest it further at a level that they're going to be assured that their business is going to grow and is going to drive this particular economy? So I think we'd encourage a review, a responsible review, MEC. I think business will be at the first of the door to say, how do we have this discussion, take it going forward? I think importantly, when you talk about business, I have to make this point. You know, often we point up at the Rupert of the world and talk about the top 10. There are many hundred thousands of businesses that employ, both in the informal, formal, and the small business sector, about 6 to 8 million people in this economy of the 15 to 16 million economically employed. Hmm. Now, when we want to paint this economy with a brush to say there must be a minimum wage, and I'm not saying we must shy away from the debate, we can't paint everyone with that same brush, because these 5 to 6 million people in the formal, informal, and small business sector is going to have a different set of solution than what those that are employed by the Ruperts of the world. And I think we must be very, very fair. And I think when we represent business, we represent array of business, not just the blue chip companies. And I think for us as business, we're saying, let's have a segmented approach and don't paint everyone, all businesses, with the same brush. Because a small business that's employing 3 people at the moment has got different challenges from what a large multinational. And in our economy, the small to medium businesses employ possibly more of our economy than any of the large corporate sector. And we mustn't forget that in the suggestions. In terms of skills development, and in particular in the support that business can offer, and I think business is first to admit, Zakhele, that the skills landscape is outdated. We've been lobbying with the further education institutions, but I think we could do more. But I think we need the door more open to suggestions to say, how can we influence the curricula? How can we influence the courses that get taken up? I mean, you have children or youngsters doing a BA in arts, BA in this. They come up with a qualification that can't be easily absorbed into the economy, or not necessarily the economy, into a career. For them, that's not practical. So I think you've hit the nail on the head. Business could do more in terms of driving and retaining a skill set that's appropriate. But business can only do it in a further education environment that is more engaging. We've advocated, we've lobbied in this province. There's a new vice chancellor at the UKZN. We've hosted him recently. Today, our president meets all the vice chancellors nationally to address partly the financial and the skills development challenge of our country. It's an emergency meeting that's been called that we want to address again. I think business wants to have a conversation, and we can do more in that conversation.
Mm-hmm. Sthembiso and Zakhele, maybe if you can respond to Mr. Ngobo's second question, the impact that corruption plays in further adding pressure to inequality.
Yeah, I think that's a very obvious thing to say. Corruption is impacting negatively to the country, to business, to alleviation of poverty. But the reality of the matter is that most of the time when you talk about corruption, we focus on the government and forget about the private sector in particular, and forget about the civil society and the labor. Mm. Because corruption runs across in South Africa. The reality of the matter is that we have these cabals within business that are standardizing the prices and fixing the prices. And the reality of the matter also is that they haven't been held accountable. So when we talk about corruption, there is corruption in government that is really affecting the poorest of the poor in the country. And I don't think it should only be the government that is involved in trying to address the issue of corruption. But all the stakeholders, all the social partners should come together and say, this is not working, it's not good for the country, it's not good for building the economy of the country, is not also good for social cohesion.
Go ahead, Edward. MEC will come back to you.
No, thanks, Gogo. You see, sometimes it won't help us to come to such panel discussions and talk good things and don't talk about the reality, because I think it's very important that we talk about the reality when we are here. You see, when we address a business as business, we address business holistically, that we are talking to business. The previous stats have shown, I'm not sure if they've changed, that 70% of our workforce, they are informal. But even the stats may not be that accurate, but there's a huge number of our workforce that is informal. And you see, Gogo, I will tell you, there are a number of interventions that have been made. The legislations have been amended. Your Labor Relations Act has been amended. Your BECA has been amended. But there is stubbornness. You'll see that if these amendments are favoring the workers, there is no compliance at all. Let me just make an example. The issue of the Section 198 of the Labor Relations Act that has been just amended, you still go to the companies, there is no enforcement of that clause. People still work as temps as usual for a number of years, for 15 years. At the end of the day, if we don't address that, those people will become a burden of the very same government. Mm. Because when they leave the workplace with nothing, they become a burden of the government. The social grants that we are talking about will keep on increasing because those people will have to rely to the government. And we are asking why then all those legislations that are in favor of workers, they are not enforceable. You see, I will tell you, as trade unions, we've made issues up around the issue of the workplace skills plan. I'll tell you, Gugu, because in the workplace forums, we've been always saying that the skills that we are producing through the workplace skills plan, they maintain the status quo. They subject those who are at the lower level of the apex to remain there, and those who are at a managerial position to keep on growing in terms of the courses that are being offered. And I must say that it's not that as Labour we're not doing anything, because I think MEC Mabuyakhulu and all the social partners, they will actually attest to that in the province. Mm. We have now our HRD committee that is sitting. And that HRD committee is to, the part of the issue is to address the issue of the skills mismatch that Zakhele was referring to, where you find that you'll have graduates that cannot have employment because the skills that they have, they do not talk to the needs of the labor market. And we think that we need to work very hard on that one. And we must be able to produce skills that will enable our people to be self-sustainable.
Mm.
Skills like artisans, exactly. Something that even if you are not employed, you are able to go and be active, economically active on your own, start your own SMME, something like that. We need to look at those skills because we understand that the issue of creating employment, it's a huge issue. But there are a number of things that we need to do. Thanks.
Edward, unfortunately, we have to leave it there for the moment. MEC, let's get your response to some of the queries raised and review the closing points with regard to what Edward has highlighted and if we are implementing these policies appropriately.
Well, let me start by the issue around what Temba has raised, the issue of the impact of corruption on inequality and what we need to do. Our starting point, I think, as a collective of social partners, that the issue of corruption in whatever level where it occurs, in whatever strata of society where it actually rears its ugly head, all of us must fight it and fight it so that we can eradicate this ill in our society. However, we must go on, Gugu, and say, in dealing with the genuine concern and invoking a sense of responsibility across society, we must guard against us painting ourselves as South Africans as the most corrupt society. Because the net impact of that, whilst we must deal with the issue of corruption, is that when we move to the alarmist position, we make the markets and everybody else who wants to invest in South Africa to shun against us. Because who on earth would want to go to a society that is corrupt to the core? Now, I think in some instances, we are therefore become the people who are doing ourselves a disservice if we go to the extreme. Now, there's a fight that all of us must fight, which is a just fight, which all of us saying we must stand up and deal with it. If it happens in the public sector, deal with it. If it happens in the private sector, deals with it. If it happens in labor, deals with it. If it happens in civil society, even in social circles like the church, because some people run away with donations of the church, and they withdraw and take millions of money, 7 million, and you read about these things. You tend to think, everybody tend to think about the state and the state alone as where you have got a pervasive culture of corruption. And I want to say to us, we're an open and transparent society, and we must maintain what our founding fathers of our democratic constitution wanted us to be, to become a democratic and transparent society. So these things are out there, and all of us can know, and we can fight it. But I'm cautioning, Bugu, against a notion and a narrative that becomes a mantra of our debate, that as if we are just a corrupt to the core. And I'm saying, yes, we do have corruption, but we must also say, because we have got organs that are fighting corruption, we must therefore invoke a sense of responsibility across society that we shall stand up and deal with corruption without fear or favor. But we must also avoid what the oppositions will do to make us look bad in the eyes of the international community and everybody to denounce South Africa as an investment, a stable investment destination.
Mm-hmm. Let me see, we're glad to hear your very firm stance when it comes to denouncing corruption. But as we wrap up the conversation, we will take on questions from the audience offline. But I'd like to get closing comments from both Zakhele and Sthembi. So we know the deliverables that government has put in place with regard to fighting the scourge that is inequality. Business has said that it is paying attention, and Edward has also highlighted the significant challenges that are felt on the ground. Sthembi, so from your view, what can civil society do in order to ensure that inequality will not be a topic of discussion in the next 5, 10, and even 20 years? Zakhele will pose the same question to you.
Yeah, it's a matter of engaging more on platforms like the KZN Economic Council.
But talking can only get us so far.
Yeah, I mean, engagement, and at the same time also holding those who are responsible for transformation accountable. can be the government, it can be the civil society, it can be the business. So the reality of the matter is that if we can have a collective and a common vision of where we as a country want to go and what kind of transformation are we talking about as a country? Because as social partners, sometimes you'll find that we are talking about transformation, we are talking about economic transformation, but our understanding of it is diverse. So it starts with us, first of all, being patriotic to this country, loving this country, and also putting the country first instead of our own interest. Then people will become conscious of the situation of the poor in the country. Once we become conscious, and we can be able to change the situation. So unless we do that, we'll, as we are saying, we'll continue with the rhetoric about talking about inequality as if we are enjoying it, the status quo. The reality of the matter, the fact of the matter is that there comes a time where people are saying, our patience has run dry, as we are seeing in South Africa now. So it's a wake-up call for all the social partners to say, the time for talking is over now, but we have created a platform like the Economic Council to say, let's address these issues once and for all. Yeah, that is the case for me.
Mm-hmm. As our thought leader, Zakhele, just to close off with, and Edward would come back to you.
I think we've spoken about inequality as a faceted a challenge, but I think if we are able to at least address the question of economic inequality, you would have at least addressed a number of other elements of inequality, and I think for me, Kuku, it's just. We need to increase the number of economic activism, people who are economic active, in the townships where we come from. There is notion of township economy. It's something that we need to really have to look at. How do we develop our townships where we come from? How do we develop rural? How do we make sure that investment, we attract investment in rural, attract investment in the township so that there is economic activism where people live, and I think we can address a number of inequality if we can address the economic inequality. Mm-hmm. That's just the last comment I just wanted to make.
Exactly, which goes back to the spatial inequalities as well that we see, not only in the province, but also from a global landscape. Zakhele, your closing comments as to, as a thought leader, your view on the contributions made by different members of civil society as well as stakeholders within the economic landscape of KZN, the balance to ensure that inequality will no longer be a topic on our agenda, hopefully in the near term.
Let me just say that I think we need to introduce this concept of sharing. In South Africa, we tend to be very, very greedy sometimes and not share. And not just with other people, but even in the family. I know people who have kids who don't even support their kids and they drive nice cars. I think as a society we need to do more to encourage people to share. I know I come from KwaMashu. Most of the schools in KwaMashu don't get the support from the people who studied in those schools. So I think we need to encourage people to be supportive, to go back to the schools where they studied, not just to be mentors, but to support the schools financially. If you look at most American universities, they get most of their money from their alumni. And this is something that we don't do very often in South Africa. So I think we need to encourage people to share, because in the long term, it's going to benefit all of us. I don't think it's good to do well as an individual, because tomorrow you're going to become a target of thugs who have been deprived. I know this guy, he's a thug, and he always says to me when he robs people, it's
redistribution of wealth. But it shouldn't happen that way. You know, if we take care of others, then I think we would reduce crime. I was in Uganda recently. Uganda is poorer than South Africa, but there's almost no crime in Uganda. So I wouldn't say that, for example, crime is caused by poverty. I think there are certain things that contribute to high levels of crime in South Africa. And I think part of it is that we live in a very materialistic society. And I think, so if you can address the issue of sharing, you know, make sure that we share what we have so that we can make everybody happy.
So clearly a change in mindset across the board to ensure that we don't resort to crime as a method of the redistribution of economic benefits. And that's the reason why we've gathered here today. Hopefully these are policies and activities that can be implored and measured again and reviewed in order to make the necessary tweaks going forward. But that's where we leave it for this edition of the KZN Economic Council Roundtable. A big thank you to all my panelists for participating in the conversation today. The MEC for Economic Development, Tourism and Environmental Affairs, Mr. Mabuyakhulu, the convener for Organized Business, Mr. Akash Singh, who's the chairman of the KZN Business Chambers Council, convener of civil society, as well as a member of the South African National Civic Organization, Mrs. Sthembiso Madlala. We're also joined by the convener of Organized Labor, as well as Provincial Secretary of Cosatu, Mr. Edward Mkhize, and our thought leader joining the panel discussion today, who is a lecturer at the University of KwaZulu-Natal, Mr. Zakhele, Ndlovu. That's where we leave it for this conversation. Do take care and join us again next time.